جزاكم الله خير السلام عليكم. الحمد لله حمد الشاكرين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. We always begin with the praise of Allah. We send our prayers of peace upon our Nabi Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And we testify that none is worthy of worship but Allah, and that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his worshipping slave and final messenger. What a wonderful introduction by our dear sister, Jazahullah Khair. Sister Razia, mashallah, you know, getting everyone active and pumped up. I was getting into the keyboard as well, mashallah, tabarakallah. I just wanted to say a quick salam to everyone. It was amazing to see how many people from so many different parts around the world have actually joined in and are interested in a topic that nobody can really ignore. And it's one of those kind of things where each and every one of us, alhamdulillah, who is in their journey of making themselves into a better person, wanting to appreciate greater and greater ways of being able to assist themselves, their loved ones, their spouse, to loving each other and enjoying each other's company. And I think one of the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a mercy for all of us is the opportunity for us to improve and to learn and to appreciate that the difficulties that we endure are really meant to be points of strength that bring us and connect us back together. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows the time that you and I spend together in these few minutes, inshallah, to be reason for us to reconnect with each other on higher levels, in greater ways, and in greater opportunities with those who we truly deep down love to a great degree. And I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens my heart and your heart to being greater in appreciation and love of the sunnah, the methodology, the habit, and the habits that were instituted by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam into bringing greater joy into the world. So I wanted to speak about the Quran and the tradition, the sunnah, as being manuals that indicate and guide us towards love. And I wanted to speak about that word love initially. You know, the word love in the Arabic language has many, many shades, many, many different Arabic usages that at times is just simply translated as that beautiful four-letter word, L-O-V-E. But in the Arabic language, you have so many different shades of meaning that are very precise. So you'll get words like rahmah. You know, you and I, we consider the word rahmah, we say Allah is ar-Rahman, that simply means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, he's the most merciful. But Allah uses that word rahmah as an essence of love. And the word rahmah and mercy has this connotation that Allah wants us to interchange with each other to achieve the mercy that we are seeking from him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, irhamu man fil ard yarhamkum man fis sama, that if you are able to grant and show mercy to those who live with you on this earth, the one beyond the heavens, subhanahu wa ta'ala, will cast his mercy upon you. And therefore, it's that very first lesson that I want to share with you, that when you look in the Quran and the Sunnah, it's not meant to just be fairy tales or legends or myths of the past. It's actually a manual of love and a manual of practice, a manual of dedicated behavior that leads us in a systematic way of achieving greatness, of achieving happiness and sa'ada in our life with each other. So when you look at that word rahmah, for example, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says is one of the things he brings down between a couple who have joined together in holy matrimony, in a blessed relationship that is pleasing to him. Now, for you and I to come together in something that is pleasing to Allah, it can only be done when it is sincere for him and in following the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, for it to be mechanized in an act of worship. So the Prophet ﷺ therefore taught us and shows us how to live a life that is full of sunnah, full of habit, in achieving that love with each other. So the word rahmah, Allah says, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. Allah brings down between a husband and wife, مَوَدَّة, which is another word that means love. We'll get to that soon, inshallah, and rahmah. Rahmah is that love that allows a person to overlook the mistake of another when they are empowered and entitled to hold them accountable. And that's why Allah is Ar-Rahman. That's why it's the only name of Allah, quality of Allah, that He uses to describe Himself unilaterally on its own. Every other one of the names of Allah, it's used in combination. Al-Hayyul Qayyum, Al-Malik, Al-Aziz. You know, all of them are in combination. But Surah Ar-Rahman, it just begins, Ar-Rahman. It's not Allahu Huwa Ar-Rahman, which He is. But Allah on its own merit, on its own importance, the word Ar-Rahman, that comes from this concept of Rahmah, that I am the one who possesses power. I am the one who has the entitlement. I am the one who can choose to hold you accountable. But out of my love for you, O my creation, even those of you who have not recognized me, have not held me into esteem, have turned away from me, that rahmah that I have for you has caused me to overlook and to show clemency and compassion and forgiveness for a period of time to give you an opportunity to adjust, even though others would not give it to you, even though I'm entitled and empowered to take it from you. And therefore, when you and I begin to think about the qualities, the names and the attributes of Allah in that particular sense, in that particular way, you and I then begin to grow fond of Allah. But when we add that as being a system for our life, a way of you and I then saying, subhanAllah, Allah wants me to be rahiman, a person who has rahmah the way He has shown rahmah, that Allah wants me to demonstrate that quality in my experience and my habits. And that's where the Quran and the Sunnah therefore become a manual that train us to achieve the things that we're seeking from Allah that we embody in our life. And subhanAllah, if there was one thing, you know, people ask this all the time, whenever I'm doing, a session or a counseling session, or, you know, there's a moment of strife or tension and people have reached out. And if there's one advice that I give to those who are not yet married, one advice that I give to those who are in their honeymoon, one advice that I give to those who are 50 years into marriage, one advice that those who have been married for 50 years will give to you and I who are just newbies, is that they will say it is more the sunnah, that which is right, the sunnah of your life with each other should be to be merciful with each other rather than to be right and proving your rights and seeking them from each other. And subhanAllah, it's been a guiding light into my life. It's been a guiding light that I hope will cast into your experiences and into your lifestyle, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. As you and I begin this journey, I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it one of rahmah that is interchanged with each other, and that we find an opportunity, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, to continue our journey, inshallah, with that regard. So let me give, inshallah, two important points about this word love and the context that we seek to achieve from it as using the Quran and the Sunnah as a manual. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells us that the greatest way of attaining our place with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and finding our contentment with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is through submission. And the word Islam simply means that you recognize that there is a relationship between you and Allah where you have made Him and taken Him to be the master, and you have assumed that you yourself are one who is given an opportunity to prove your worth to Him. And one of the greatest ways for you and I to ensure our commitment to Allah is in how we commit to those who he has brought into our inner circle and sphere. And there is no greater test for you and I in this life, no greater mission for you and I in this life than to achieve harmony and balance with those who others will take for granted on account of the nearness of their relationships. One of the reasons Allah regularly in the Quran invites us to being dutiful, kind, and not rebelling against our parents is because they will become the greatest test for us in life and will become the greatest test for us on the Day of Judgment. Allah says to us in the Quran, "Inna min azwajikum," from your spouses, subhanAllah, pay attention to this ayah, in this context, aduwan lakum, an enemy to you. And you say, whoa, Brother Yahya, I came here to fall in love. I didn't care here to come in and find fault and enemy. Well, actually, you need to pay attention to the context of this ayah. Your husband, your wife, on the Day of Judgment will be your greatest adversity for you to attain a place and a standing in Jannah. Because they're the ones who you have the greatest friction with, the greatest contact with, the greatest familiarity with, which means by necessity, they are the ones who you will have the greatest rights upon and from, and they will be the ones who you are always connecting with, hopefully in a positive way, that you pass that test with success. In the same way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Al-akhillah, ba'duhum li ba'din adu. On the Day of Judgment, those who were best friends in this life will be the most avowed enemies, illa al-muttaqoon, except those who built their friendship upon piety. So I want you to consider that the relationship you are building with your spouse is one that's not just about an emotional connection, a physical connection, an economic connection, a social connection, but it's in fact the very heart of your spiritual salvation towards your future hereafter eternal life. It is the thing that your soul seeks emancipation through to find its place with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I want that to be the kind of context that you and I build. So let's speak a little bit about love. The word conventionally used for love in the Arabic language is al-hub. You know, hub, mashallah, it's two letters, right? All right, for you, mashallah, linguists, ha and ba, they're actually a very tough combination. You know, the letter ha, now you could say that with me, actually, if you can. Ha, it's from the back of your throat, it's guttural, it's from deep down in your chest, ha. And it's an expression, you pull it out. And it's one of the toughest letters to say in the Arabic language in combination. And that's why when you begin learning the Quran or you go to study it and you come to the Imam and you say Alhamdu, you say, no, it's not Alhamdu, it's Alhamdu, Hamdu. So when you pronounce it, it takes a stress. It's got a point of flexion in your voice. And Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim, he says that the word hub, it's two letters, two simple letters. Most Arabic words come from a tri-letter root, three letters. But hub, it's two letters. The first letter is difficult to be pronounced, difficult to be spoken, difficult because the concept of love is difficult to attain, difficult to gather, difficult to find, difficult to master, difficult to keep in the longevity. The second letter is the most phonic letter that all human beings use in all languages that humanity have used. Ba 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 ba, right? And your baby, they'll begin to babble, you know, babbling. And it's a very phonic, the sound that's emitted with the ba, it's in all of the languages of the world. So you have the ha, which is very difficult, very unique, very Arabic in its sound, very Semitic in its origin, and then you have the ba, which is, you know, ba is, everybody can say it. And Al-Imam Ibn Al-Qayyim says, well, the beginning of love is difficult, but to lose it, to end it, to bring it to ruin, it's smooth and it's almost like it flows off the tongue. The word hub, it also comes from the word to mean, you know, if you change the accent from the dhamma over the ha to a fatha, it's hab. Habab al-asnan, meaning the essential whiteness of the teeth, meaning as-safa, purity. So love was always meant to be something that's pure, unadulterated, that isn't something that's changing and evolving with time. It's meant to be something that is static, something that it's ups and downs. There's a baseline that's always there. It never nosedives. It might peak, but it always stabilizes at a place of elevation. It never goes underwater. It never pulls you down under. And he continues by saying that this concept of hub, this love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we seek, is one that is established by fidelity and nearness to each other. So one of the beautiful hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would make the dua of Prophet Dawood. And he taught us that Prophet Dawood used to make dua. He would say, Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbak. Oh Allah, I ask you for your love. Wa hubba man yuhibbuk, and the love of those who love you. Wa hubba al-amal alladhi yuqarribuna ila hubbik, and the love of the actions that bring me to being loved by you, oh Allah. Which shows us to be loved by Allah takes work and it takes communion with other people. Wa hubba man yuhibbuk. Oh Allah, allow me to love you and allow me to receive the love of those who love you, to work in tandem with those who love you. Allah tells us in Surah Al-Ma'idah, very early on in the fifth chapter of the Quran, وَتَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Assist one another to that which gives you birr, righteous modality and conduct, and taqwa, and a clarity of heart and consciousness with Allah. وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Don't help one another in rebellion against each other and against God, and in animosity towards His creation, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those are important kind of statements that you and I need to consider when we're talking about love, and as we're going to relate it to our household life, right? So, hub is purity. It also comes from the word habba, which means a seed, because love never begins in full bloom. And when you hear those kind of Hollywood-y, soapy opera-y kind of discussions about love and that fraudulent love, right? You know, that instantaneous, you know, our eyes met across the room and that was it. You know, everything's time stood still. And love is actually endurance. It's meant to be resilience. Love is going through what pulls you away from each other that actually strengthens you. And that's why they call it tying the knot, which is actually a very important Islamic concept. In a beautiful hadith narrated by Abu Dawood, Aisha radiallahu anha, she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's why the Sunnah is like this manual of love. She says, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sif hubbak. Describe, not tell me, do you love me, but describe how you love me. So the Prophet ﷺ said, Ya Aisha, fahuwa qal'iqd. It's like a knot that has been tied, meaning that whenever anything is pulling at us, whenever there's tension, whenever there's hardship, whenever there's, you know, the mushrikeen are attacking, or Uhud, or this or that, whenever there's things in life that are seeking to pull us away from each other, the love that is between us tightens. So it's a tighter knot. When we got married. So Aisha radiallahu anha, she loves that. You know, she loves that the Prophet describes his love as a tightly bound knot. And she would use this as their code language, right? Their code language of love. And she would ask randomly, you know, at different times, people don't know the context of this statement. So she would say, Ya Rasulullah, كيف العقد اليوم? He'd be sitting and, you know, she'd call out, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how is your how is that knot today? And people are like, what knot? What are you referring to? And the Prophet would say, ka'awwali yawmin rubat. It's as tight as the first day we tied it. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Powerful kind of imagery that you take from the sunnah and the growth and the strength and the pulling through and the struggles and so on. So when we speak about love, we've spoken about that one word, hub. We've given it three important shades of meaning, three important qualifications as it's used from the Arabic language. It's tough to come by, it's tough to maintain, but it's easily lost. Ha and ba, right? Remember those two letters. Number two, we said that it's meant to be pure, unadulterated. It's not meant to be self-serving. It's not meant to be for the benefit of another. It's not meant to be that, you know, it's dressed up and it's, you know, it's impure. It's meant to be clear and beautiful in that sense. And number three is that the love that we have for each other is meant to be one that grows and is nurtured. So the Arab, they used to use the word hub, hab, meaning it's like a seed, and seeds require energy and hard work for them to bloom. So consider that the word for success in the Arabic language, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, successful are the believers. The word أَفْلَحَ, فَلَحَ, those three letters, they're the same three letters that you would use to describe a farmer. What does farming and success have in common? Both of them require backbreaking, consistent, day in, day out labor and hard work that goes for a long period of time before the harvest is reaped. And that's success. That's the concept of success, that you gotta put in, you gotta work at it. It's not gonna always be a garden, but you need somebody who's gonna be there, who's gonna till the soil, remove its impurities, irrigate the land, make sure that it's not shaded too much from the sun or that there's too much exposure to the sun. That's before you've even planted the seed. You gotta fertilize it and turn it over. You gotta make sure that it's ready. And when it's the right time and the right place, you have to plant the right seed in the right part of the ground. And you got to grow the right kind of fruit or the right kind of tree or the right kind of vegetable in the right season. And you have to be opportunistic and you have to be learned and you have to be strategic. Look at how they understood love. So then you take that one seed that you and I underestimate how much can grow from it, how much spectacular potential and growth can come from this one thing that others cast away. You take that apple seed, nobody really eats the core. You cast away the seed and the core, but that little seed can germinate if it's put in the right condition, given to the right person, utilized for the right purpose, can grow into a spectacular tree with deep roots, a strong trunk, branching branches that are born and full of fruit that are enjoyed not just by the one who planted it, by everything else that is sheltered by it. How many other things will be nourished from that one seed in its awesome potential of being? And once that seed is put into that fertile heart, and once it's irrigated and weeds are removed from it and pests insecticide is, you know, cleaning the area and just being on guard and always monitoring it. And then you allow that tree to grow. And as it begins to bloom, resist the urge to take the flower. Let that flower become something greater. Let it turn into fruit. Don't just, you know, pick it before it's too early, and let it ripen. And once its season has ended, know that it's not dead and it can regrow again. And that imagery of love is a powerful, powerful image that the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam call to. My mission, of course, is to lead you in these next couple of days and into the future, inshallah, into this challenge and ability to connect with each other on a deeper level, not just using social and psychological and important methods and tried and tested counseling and therapy, but to actually give the Quran and the Sunnah the chance that maybe we had not previously assumed that it deserves in leading us in our contemporary lifestyle towards happiness and sa'ada. And that takes us back to that very first advice that I would give and others would give. If you were to give advice to one person, what would it be? It's to add rahmah, to add that type of love, Hold on a second. Is there more than one type of love? Yes. And I'm not talking about, you know, the five languages of love and all that kind of stuff. You're going to read a lot about that and hear a lot about that. And there's so much we're going to benefit from that. But I want you to go a little bit further than that. I want you to see that the Quran also speaks about the names and attributes of Allah that he says to us near the end of Surah Maryam. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ سَيَجْعَلُ لَهُمُ الرَّحْمَنُ وُدَّا. Those who believe and work righteousness in whatever capacity of their life, in their workplace, in their family, with their children, as a husband, as a father, as a son, as a daughter, those who believe and work righteous deeds, سَيَجْعَلُ لَهُمُ الرَّحْمَنُ, the merciful one, the bestower of this particular type of love, will create for them wudda. One of the names of Allah is Al-Wadud, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wudda, to be given love by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sayaj'alu, he will create it for them in this life and into the next life. And you know, Al-Imam Sufyan ibn Uyayna, one of the great muhaddith scholars, he's the teacher of the tabi'een, those who lived in the era of the sahaba, of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and others, he would say in about how to fix relationships, aslih ma baynaka wa bayna Allah yaslih Allahu ma baynaka wa bayna an-nas. If you are capable of fixing what is between you and Allah, begin there so that you will be aided by Allah to fix what is between you and other people. And, you know, I want to end with this. You know, sometimes, subhanAllah, there'll be moments of tension between my wife and I. And yes, you know, you can speak about love and you can speak about marriage and have moments of difficulty and have moments where you need somebody to assist you and, you know, to benefit from the talks that Sister Razia gives and Sister Manahil give, and to hear a different perspective and to wake up to, you know, the affirmation mantra that we, you know, that you typed out on the board where, yes, my marriage is important. My marriage is a blessing from Allah. And sometimes we forget that, you know, it's something that happens. And it doesn't matter if you're the educator or the one being educated, both of us benefit from each other. And I know that as the questions start to come along and as we get ready for the VIP session, which is coming in a few minutes, where I'll take some of the questions and be led through it with Sister Razia, I want you to know that I benefit from it as well. And, you know, in moments of tension between my wife and I, one of the key aspects is to learn that conflict and its resolution is not always something that is attainable, that it is okay to have conflict that is managed and mitigated by the essentials of love and the essentials of mercy. That, yeah, I don't agree with her, she doesn't agree with me, but the mercy we have with each other compels us to be more mature, more loving than seeking to prove our point, seeking to have the last word, seeking to end the argument where I feel I have been given victory, that I showed her. Yeah, she knows who's boss, right? She knows who wears the jubba around the house, right? That kind of thing is really important for us to consider. And love, mercy are synonyms within the construct of the Quran. And I hope, inshallah, as we proceed forward and as we discuss more relevant issues, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may place mercy in our hearts towards each other, that Allah benefits us with what we learn and what we seek and what we're interested in, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides us along the way, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if He in His immense wisdom upon us that is divine, that is beyond our understanding, challenges us with hardship in a moment within our household, that Allah also allows us the opportunity to find love through Him, through our practice of mercy and patience and worship of Him. Of the greatest act of worship that a human being can commit to is to fulfill half of their deen, half of their responsibility, through a nurturing, content, loving, conflict-filled at times, but mercy-infused relationship that is built on a love that bleeds, that is found in a marriage that can lead us to Jannah. Like, I want you to think of that concept, that your marriage becomes the vehicle for you and I to get to Jannah, becomes the way for you and I to achieve half of our deen, fulfillment of half of our responsibility, preparing the khulafa who will take the earth from us, and a new generation that will lead on after our departure. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala assist you and I in that regard, and may Allah fulfill our hopes and dreams. Allahumma ameen. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Let me turn on the lights. I don't even know why it got so dark, man. Something wrong with my settings. Forgive me for that. I'll get it adjusted shortly, inshallah. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.